fusion of entertainment and enlightenment. This is the Glenn Beck Program.
I've been a Democrat for 20 years, but my experience made me realize just how out of touch my party is with the country at large. This is an amazing story written by a woman on the left, or a Democrat, and I want to read it verbatim because it is awesome. Listen to this. I think those of us on the left need to take a long look in the mirror and have an honest conversation about what's going on. If you had told me 3 years ago I would ever attend a Donald Trump rally, I would have laughed and assured you that there was never any chance of that happening. Heck, if you had told me I would do that 3 months ago, I probably would have done the same thing. So how did I find myself among an 11,000-plus Trump supporter rally in Manchester, New Hampshire? Believe it or not, it all started with knitting. You might not think of the knitting world as a particularly political community. I honestly have never even thought of it as a community, but you'd be wrong, she writes. Many knitters are active in social justice communities and love to discuss the revolutionary role knitters have played in our culture. And I started noticing this about a year ago, particularly on Instagram. I knit as a way to relax and escape from the drama of real life, not to further engage with it. But it was impossible to ignore after roving gangs of online social justice warriors started going after anyone in the knitting community who was not lockstep in their ideology. Can you believe this has gone to the knitting community? Knitting stars, didn't know there were, but knitting stars on Instagram were bullied and mobbed by hundreds of people for seemingly innocuous offenses. One man got mobbed so badly that he had a nervous breakdown and was admitted to the hospital on suicide watch. Many things were not right about the hatred, and witnessing the vitriol coming from those I had aligned myself with politically was a massive wake-up call. Democrats have an ass-kicking coming to them in November, and I think most of them will be utterly shocked when it happens. You see, I was one of those Democrats who considered everyone who voted for Trump a racist. I thought they were horrible, yes, even deplorable, and worked very hard to eliminate their voices from my spaces by unfriending or blocking people who spoke about their support of him, however minor their comments. I watched a lot of MSNBC and was convinced that everything he had done was horrible and that he hated anyone who wasn't a straight white man. And he had no redeeming qualities. But when I witnessed the amount of hate coming from the left in this small niche knitting community, I started to question everything. I started making a proactive effort to break my echo chamber by listening to voices that I thought I would disagree with. I wanted to understand their perspective, believing that it would confirm that they were filled with hate for anyone who wasn't like them. That has turned out not to be the case. The more voices outside the left I listened to, the more I realized that these were not bad people. They were not racist, Nazis, or white supremacists. We had differences of opinion on social and economic issues. But a difference of opinion does not make your opponent inherently evil. They could justify their opinions using arguments rather than shouting and the ranting that I saw coming from my side of the aisle. I started to discover, or perhaps rediscover, the hashtag walkaway movement. I had heard about walkaway when MSNBC told me it was fake and nothing but a bunch of Russian bots. But then I started to meet real people who had been Democrats and made the decision to leave because they couldn't stand the way the left was behaving. I watched town halls where they had differing minority communities, all available on YouTube. And I saw sane, rational discussions from people of different races, backgrounds, orientations, and experiences. I joined the Facebook group for the community and saw stories popping up daily of people sharing why they were leaving the Democratic Party. This wasn't fake. These people aren't Russian bots. Moreover, it felt like a breath of fresh air. There was not universal agreement in this group. Some were Trump supporters. Some weren't. but they talked and shared their perspective without shouting or rage or trying to cancel each other. I started to question everything. How many stories had I been sold that weren't true? What if my perception of the other side is wrong? How is it possible that half the country is overtly racist? Is it possible that Trump derangement syndrome is a real thing and that I had been suffering from it from the last 3 years? And the biggest question of all was this. Did I hate Donald Trump so much that I wanted to see my own country fail just to spite him and everyone who voted for him? Now, fast forward to the New Hampshire primary. And we've all seen the politicians running around the state making their case. I've seen almost every Democratic candidate in person and noticed that their messages were almost universally one of doom and gloom, not only focusing on the obvious disagreements with Donald Trump, but also making sure to emphasize that the country is a horribly racist place. Now, I do believe that there are real issues when it comes to race and that we as a society haven't reckoned with them yet. And while the 2017 protest in Charlottesville, Virginia, led to a tragedy precipitated by real racists and real Nazis, real white supremacists, I started to see that those labels simply don't apply to most people who support Donald Trump. But with all of this, I was still reticent to even consider attending a Trump event. I don't believe that Trump's attitude is worthy of the highest office of the land. I abhor his Twitter. I vehemently opposed so many of his policies. But still, I wanted to see for myself. I'm not going to lie. I was very nervous. So I thought I'd start my day in familiar territory at an MSNBC live show in New Hampshire that was taking place a few blocks away from the rally. I decided to wear my red hat that looks like a Trump hat, but with one small difference. It says, "Make speech free again." The funny thing about that hat is that it is completely open to interpretation. When I wear it around left-leaning people, they think I'm talking about the right. When I wear it around right-leaning folks, they think I'm talking about the left. It's just another stark reminder of how much our own perspective and biases play into how we view the world. In chatting with the folks at the taping, I casually said I was thinking about going over to the Trump rally. Well, the first reaction they had was a genuine fear for my safety. I have never seen people I didn't know so passionately urge me to avoid all of those people. One told me that those people were the lowest of low. Another man told me that they had gone to one of Trump's rallies in the past, and he had been a target of harassment by large, muscle-bound men. Another woman actually offered me her pepper spray. I assured them all that I thought I would be fine and I'd get the heck out of Dodge if I got nervous. What they didn't know is that they weren't the only ones I had heard from who said they should be afraid. Some of my more right-leaning friends online expressed genuine fear at my going, not because they were afraid of the attendees, but they were afraid of people on the left violently attacking the attendees. This was a day after a man had run his car through a Republican voter registration tent in Florida. There was genuine fear that this would be repeated or that Antifa would bus people in from Boston for it. Just as I assured those on the left, I told them that I thought I would be fine because we really don't have Antifa in New Hampshire. But I'm not going to tell you that it didn't get to me a bit. When everyone around you is nervous for your safety, it's hard not to question if they have a point. Well, I attended. I couldn't help but think, if they could just see the world through the lens of the other for a moment or two, it would be a stark revelation that they don't know as much as they think they do. This was so different than any other political event I had ever attended. The energy around Barack Obama in 2008 didn't even feel like this. So I headed over for an hour and a half before the doors were scheduled to open, which was 4 hours before Trump was set to take the stage, and a line already stretched a mile away from the entrance to the arena. As I waited, I chatted with folks around me. And contrary to all the fears expressed, they were so nice. I was not harassed or intimidated. I was never in fear of my safety, even for a moment. These were just average, everyday people. They were veterans, school teachers, and small business owners who have come from all over the place for the thrill of attending this rally. They were upbeat and excited. In chatting, I even let it slip out from time to time that, yes, I was a Democrat. The reaction was, good for you. Welcome. What else happened? And what did she finally discover? And what is she now sharing, I believe, at her own peril? An article written by a Democrat on what she has discovered because she was forced to look at her own side because of all of the hatred that she found in an Instagram community, her Instagram community, and she couldn't believe the social justice warriors. So she went to the Trump rally and she writes, "Once I got inside, the atmosphere was jubilant. It was more like attending a rock concert than a political rally. People were genuinely enjoying themselves. Some were even dancing to the music being played over the loudspeakers. It was so different than anything else I'd ever attended. I had attended an event with all the Democratic contenders just 2 days prior in exactly the same arena. And the contrast was stark. First, Trump completely filled the arena all the way to the top. Even every other major Democratic candidate, with all of them in attendance just the other night, and the campaigns giving away free tickets, the Democrats couldn't do that. With Trump, every single person was unified around a singular goal. With the Democrats, the audience booed over candidates they didn't like and got into literal shouting matches with each other. With Trump, there was a genuinely optimistic view of the future. With the Democrats, it was all doom and gloom. With Trump, a genuine feeling of pride of being an American. With Democrats, they emphasized that the country was a racist place from top to bottom." Now, Trump is always going to be, he's always going to present the best case he can. And yes, he lies, and that's provable. But the strength of his rally wasn't about facts and figures. It was a group of people who felt like they had someone finally in their corner who would fight for them. Some people say, well, obviously they're having a great time. They're in a cult. I don't think that's true. The reality is that many people I spoke to do disagree with Trump on things. They don't always like his attitude. They do wish he wouldn't tweet so much. People who are in cults don't question their leaders. The people I spoke with did. But the pros in their eyes far outweighed the cons. They don't love him because they think he's perfect. They love him despite his flaws because he has their backs. As I left the rally, walking past thousands of people who were watching it on a giant monitor outside the arena in the cold because they couldn't get in, I knew there was no way Trump would lose in November. Absolutely no way. I truly believe it doesn't matter who the Democrats nominate. Trump will trounce them. If you don't believe me, attend one of his rallies and see for yourself. Don't worry, they really won't hurt you. Today, I voted in the New Hampshire Democratic Party, and I voted for Pete Buttigieg. I genuinely feel Pete would be great for this country, and maybe he'll have his opportunity in the future. But tomorrow, I'll be changing my voter registration from Democrat to Independent and walking away from the party I've spent the last 20 years in, and sit in the middle for a while. There are extremists in both parties that I'm uncomfortable with, but I also fundamentally believe that most people on both sides are good, decent human beings who want the best for the country and have a dramatic disagreement on how to get there. But until we start seeing each other as human beings, there will be no bridging this divide. And I refuse to be a part of the divisiveness any longer. I refuse to hate people I don't know simply because they choose to vote for someone else. If we're going to heal the country, we have to start taking steps toward one another rather than away. I think Democrats have an ass-kicking coming to them in November, and I think most of them are going to be utterly shocked when it happens because they are existing in an echo chamber that is not reflective of the broader reality. I hope it's a wake-up call that causes them to take a long look in the mirror and really ask themselves, how did we get here? Maybe then they'll start listening. I tend to doubt it, but I can hope.
Sounds like a bot. Direct from Moscow.
You know what that is? That's a Trump supporter pretending. That is so brave. So brave of this individual.
Yeah, I mean, it shows a lot of vulnerability, right? I mean, if you're going, you're getting won over by a rally, essentially. That's not something typically want to admit.
Yeah, and I don't think she was won over by the rally. She was won over by the kindness of the people and the openness of the people who she had been told would, you know, hurt her and destroy her.
Yeah.
And that's honestly, that is what we hear from every single person who is on the Democratic side or was against us or whatever. And they sit down with us and we talk. And this happens in your home and your life as well. And people always say, this is so nice. This is so friendly. Everybody on the conservative side is so friendly. That's not true. Not everybody is. But most people are, because we've thought things through and we disagree with the policies. And we have been called names for so long. Most of us don't want to call you names. You know, most of us don't want, because you disagree with us, we don't want, but putting up with the harassment and the social justice warriors and seeing so many Democrats just sit on their hands and do nothing when they can clearly see what's going on makes us think, you know, you must be part of it. And, you know, so maybe sometimes our willingness to accept somebody like Donald Trump, who will just verbally punch people in the face, it does feel good after a while. It does feel good. But I think a majority of us don't like it. But as she said, at least somebody's standing up for our side. At least somebody is pushing back and is not betraying us.
And then she said, beep, boop, because she had a malfunction in her bot. Because right. She's a bot and she's Russian. And then she said, Yasibyat! Yasibyat! Just like Ivan Drago.
Really?
He said, for me, I fight to win for me. Wow. Yeah, and then he took on the Politburo, the whole thing.
Wow,
and then
amazing.
He threw, like, the Russian president, like, on the side, okay. And it's like, why did he get in trouble?